organização. É, para nós, no Centro de Estudos SES, é um grande prazer ter aqui dois colegas que neste momento trabalham na Austrália. Um é o José da Costa, que foi parte do processo, que sofreu na pele todo o processo da invasão do governo da Indonésia e de ser um refugiado dentro do seu país, e depois, mais tarde, é parte da Epopeia, do único barco que consegue chegar à Austrália e ter o estatuto de refugiado. E a partir dessa experiência que ele nos vem contar hoje, o que é que significou a luta desta viagem, o que é que esta viagem ainda hoje, porque é que é importante o filme, que também toda a história da resistência e da luta que aconteceu em Timor-Leste e que muitas vezes nos passa um pouco despercebida esta luta feita no dia-a-dia por pessoas comuns, que foram de facto a grande estrutura de resistência em Timor-Leste. O José tem formação de professor de escola primária, tem escrito uma data de livros, tem vários livros de histórias para crianças e, portanto, e além de trabalhar nos filmes, que é a sua grande referência, portanto, damos as boas-vindas ao SES. A Vanessa Harman é indonésia, trabalha na Austrália, professora na Universidade de Dairon, que era há bocado, estávamos aqui a falar um bocado o que é que Dairon tem a ver com a Austrália, porque é assim uma daquelas perplexidades que de vez em quando a gente se... mas são daquelas pequenas idiosincrasias que o conhecimento imperial tem. Mas ela é professora na Universidade de Charles Darwin, na Austrália. Tem um grande trabalho sobre o ativismo político e a memória. A sua experiência também como Indonésia e na luta que a Indonésia desenrolou também para apoiar a libertação de Timor, que no meu caso pessoal foi uma das grandes lições que aprendi em Timor, é separar o que é a luta contra o governo da Indonésia do apoio do povo da Indonésia. Foi uma grande lição para mim esta separação que se faz entre quem são os participantes na luta. A Vanessa tem trabalhado, no caso de Timor, a sua ligação vem de ter trabalhado numa categoria muito especial, que era tradutora das Nações Unidas no período de transição. Portanto, depois no intervalo poderão perguntar qual foi a experiência dela nessa situação esquizofrénica, que é fazer tradução de coisas com que provavelmente ela não estaria de acordo, mas isso é um pequeno detalhe da vida anterior dela como tradutora. Portanto, ela tem trabalhado muito, somente sobre o problema que acontece, que vai marcar profundamente a Indonésia, que é a chegada do regime ditatorial ao poder em 65, 66 e a grande purga anticomunista, que vai afetar radicalmente Timor-Leste, vai afetar a Indonésia e que vai ter depois, mais tarde, implicações sobre na ocupação de Timor-Leste. Hoje, a palestra, como é que se chama este seminário, já está, é um seminário em que nós vamos, de facto, falar, acho que eu já vi, depois de visto aqui, há bocado estava a mexer na questão, vamos falar da apresentação dela, sobre a viagem da Tassi Dayak, que é a viagem que o José faz, do Lourdes. Estava à espera que eu estivesse aqui. Este site, sometimes they change and then it becomes a community. I never know where it is. It's somewhere. Yes. But anyway, in the afternoon you'll see that there is the film and you'll be able to watch it at 9 o'clock. We invite you already for the session that will take place tonight at 9 o'clock. Mas hoje vamos ter aqui a Vanessa e o José, especialmente o José, a falar desta experiência que foi esta viagem de fuga de um regime ditatorial, que é uma questão muito interessante, quando o colonialismo é substituído por outro regime colonial, e o que é que significou a procura de asilo na Austrália, que era uma das grandes referências, supostamente, de regimes democráticos e abertos. E o que é que significou esta viagem Boat People, que é um termo que hoje se fala muito. E ele, na primeira mão, nos vai falar dessa experiência e do que é que isto significou. Portanto, muito bem-vindos ao SES. Obrigada por estarem cá. I just made a presentation in Portuguese.
So we thought what we might do is for José to speak first about his experiences, and then I'll then talk a little bit about the boat voyage and how the boat voyage impacted on Australia-Indonesia relations. Mm-hmm. So we thought we might do it in that order first. So,
thank you very much. I'm sorry that I have to speak in English, because I think when I was born, Portuguese already left East Timor, and I think my parents were quite too busy trying to move around the bush and trying to survive. So I didn't have a chance to study Portuguese, so that's a part of the reason. I just like to give a little bit background of why we actually sailed from East Timor to Australia. Just trying to give you some kind of background. I was born in 1976, a couple months of the Indonesian invasion. So you know, I was born in the jungle. My parents was running away from the invasion by the Indonesian army. And it was very, very difficult for us and a lot of my parents, family members, siblings were killed during the bombardment by the Indonesian troops, who were actually chasing the populations during that time. So I was grow up at that period. So the history that we learned was all about the violence and invasions and then, you know, our night story, you know, bad stories were all about kings and imprisoned and of course my parents was running around the bush for 3 years. They moving from one place to another, and then 3 years later they got captured, and then the army sent us back to our village. But of course at that time was also the village also were controlled by the army, so we cannot allow to go back and live in our own village to grow food and to farm. So they displaced us in our own hometown. So every time we go to our farm, we have to have a special travel permissions from the army in order to go to collect food from the farm. So, I mean, I remember very well, you know, when I was young, I was very close to my father. And I always follow him to the farm and to collect food. But one day, you know, my father's travel documents was expired. So the Indonesians was like, they were very angry with him. You know, why you didn't want to renew his your travel documents? They started to punish him and force him to guard the Indonesian army's post every night. And 1 year later, in 1984, and they actually finally found out that my father was involved in their clandestine and involved in the resistance movements. So yeah, they killed him. So they killed my father after that. So since then, you know, I have this mentality that, you know, this is the something that we have to do as a young people. You know, we have to fight for this country, you know, to liberate the people, you know, from the invasions. So in 1987, I actually left my village, my home district, Bakau, to Dili, and this is where I start to involve in the clandestine movements in Dili. Now, I was when I left my hometown. I was about 11 years old. And in 1989, there was a Pope, John Paul II, visit East Timor at that time. So it's kind of the East Timor start to have some sort of international attention through the Pope's visit. So at that time we were start involved with the demonstration, and then I was very small boy at that time. I was almost scorched by the crowd. I was in the middle of the, and the army were, you know, it was a banner of the you know, freedom movement, and then the army start to, you know, torture the young people. They throw their chairs around, and then I was almost caught in the middle of the crowd. And then since then the everyday resistance, in East Timor was start to get stronger, stronger. So, you know, and then in 1990. Was the visit of the American ambassador to Dili, John Major, was his name. And then we had a demonstration as well, and then, you know, just to show to the American ambassador that, you know, we are actually fight for our freedom here. And from there on, the everyday resistance that, you know, struggle against the Indonesian army, Indonesian police, was almost everyday activities for the young people. But one thing that about our struggles is we never touch the ordinary Indonesian citizens, because we realized that, you know, this Indonesian's ordinary citizen is just like one of us, you know, trying to survive from the dictatorship, to help the dictatorship. So we hardly, you know, create any conflict, and they have a freedom. We give the freedom to, you know, to do business, and, you know, to run restaurant, and, you know, everyday life business. Our main target was about, you know, to do with the Indonesian army and Indonesian authority. You know, that was our mission. And of course, in 1991, I think, you know, that was the biggest event in East Timor. And you know, we were sort of like, you know, we were waiting for a Portuguese parliamentarian's visit to East Timor, and then we kind of ready now to organize you know, massive demonstrations, you know, to welcome the Portuguese parliamentarian. But of course they didn't, they canceled the visit. And then, but we continue, you know, to carry on with the movements. So in on the 28th and of October 1991, was a group of young people that actually, you know, hiding in the church, in the Mosaic Church in Dili, in East Timor, and they were attacked by the Indonesian army intelligence, Indonesian army, and then they killed, you know, one of our friends, Preston Gomez, and then the rest of the people who were hiding inside the church, they got arrested and sent to jail, and including one of my friends, Antonio Govea. So he was a part of our group that we came to, we signed to Australia by boat. So 2 weeks after that, you know, we had a massive demonstrations, thousands of young people demonstrated, and we carried for, because Timor is, you know, Catholic, and, you know, after somebody's death, we have to take flowers to the cemetery and to remember his death. So anyway, we also had peaceful demonstrations, and we had a lot of banners and, you know, the slogans and, you know, screaming for freedom. And of course, when we arrived at the Santa Cruz Cemetery, the army was already waiting for us at the cemetery and everywhere. And as soon as we entered the cemetery, the army actually opened the fire and killed so many of us. Like, so it was about 270 of the young people were killed. Just a matter of, you know, 15, 20 minutes. And there was chaos, and, you know, I was trying to run and jumping over the fence and survived. And a lot of the injury during the shooting were taken to the hospital, and then a lot of them also killed after that, and then a lot of them, you know, imprisoned. And so 2 weeks later, you know, I was unlucky, and then I also got arrested by the Indonesian police patrol. So I was sent to prison. I was only 15 at that time, so I was they sent me to the police prison, and I was badly tortured and electric shock, and, you know that was the consequence of the, you know, dictator. You know, when you fight against the dictatorship and regime, you know, that's the consequence that you face. But of course, we realize that that's the price of the freedom that we have to pay. And then, you know, a lot of friends were killed, and a lot of us in prison and disappeared. So since then, you know, our life was very much in danger. So we have to hide, you know, from one place to another, and you know, we have to try to, you know, avoid the Indonesian army and the Indonesian police and Indonesian intelligence. So, and then, of course, the international attention for East Timor was getting, you know, bigger. So we want to bring East Timor struggle to another level. So in 1994, was a lot of students, East Timor students who were studied in Indonesia, or they were trying to jump into a foreign embassy, like American embassy and a Holland embassy. And there was a first group, 29 students were jumping to the Indonesian, American embassy. And then they came to Portugal to seek a political asylum here in Portugal. And in 1995, you know, we were organized a very small fishing boat, and then we consulted with the resistance leader that you know, whether it's a good idea for us to go to Australia to seek a political asylum. And then, you know, one of the resistance leader, he was a priest, you know, Father Domingos Mombere. He was one of the well-known Timorese priests in East Timor who actually helped the young people, you know, to organize the demonstrations and then giving out information from inside and outside to the resistance fighter in the jungle. And then also, one of the resistance leaders, he was an academic, Armindo Maia. He was the rector of the university during Indonesian time, UNTIM, and today is known as UNTL, and he was a rector at that time. And also we consulted with one of the resistance leader, Nino Connie Santana. He was when Santana was in jail, he replaced Sanana as the chief of the army leaders in the jungle. And they say, it is a good idea for us. And then they ask, how are you going to get there? How are you going to get to Australia? Are you going to Jakarta to jump into the Australian embassy? We say, no, we're trying to take a risk. We're going to sail from Delhi to Australia. And they say, oh, okay, I think that's a good idea. And then they all agreed. So we had a meeting with Padre Domingos Mambere and then Armindo Maia, and they said, well, it's good because we have to stop Australia's armed deals with Indonesia, and we have to distract the diplomacy lobbying. We sailed from Delhi, and it took us 5 nights and 6 days to get to Darwin, Australia. But it was very, very difficult because our boat was very small, and the waves was very strong, and after 3 days of sailing, we thought, oh, we're gonna die, you know, like the boat was like, you know, up and down in the sea, and then crash against the waves, and we thought that the boat is going to split into two, and we all sank. But we didn't. We ended up into the Australian water, and we got picked up by the Australian Coast Guard, and then they lead us to Australian Navy Center in Darwin. And when we got there, sort of like we were very jet lags, seasick, and we didn't speak, you know, a word of English, but of course my friend Alfredo Reynado Alves, he had a very, very little English, so we'd be able to. And then the Australian Coast Guard asked us, where do you come from, sir? Timor-Leste. And they say, Indonesia? No, Timor-Leste. You know, we're trying to maintain, you know, our identity that we are Timorese, we are not Indonesian. So, and what language do you speak? Do you speak Bahasa Indonesia? So no, we speak Tetum. So we try to avoid, we speak Tetum. So that was our political mission, that we're trying to show that, you know, we have a different language, and, you know, we have a different identity. So we had three interpreter, Tetum language interpreter came and they interpreted for us. But of course, when we arrived in Australia, we were they treated us as illegal migrants. So the Australian authority, Australian immigration, sent us to the detention center for 6 or 7 weeks. But we were the lucky one, actually. Because when we arrived at the detention center, Courting-based detention center, there was a lot of Chinese and a lot of Vietnamese. They already there for some of them already there for 2 or 3 years already in there. And because our case was a little bit of a political issue. And then I think Dr. Vanessa Giam is going to talk about more in her research about how the political issues come. And at that time was a coincidence. When we arrived in Australia by boat, was a little bit coincident, because one of the Indonesian army generals, General Mantiri, he was just about to come to Australia as an Indonesian ambassador. There was a big questions about the diplomacy, you know, between Australia and Indonesia at that time. because of our case. And they finally, they canceled. They canceled as general and he became the ambassador from Indonesia to Australia. So it was a massive report. And of course, the Habibie, when we arrived, Habibie was, I think he was the technology administrator at that time. So when we arrived, he was in Australia, and the journalists started, you know, ask him about our arrival, you know, what about, you know, the issue of East Timor and what we think about it. And then was very difficult for them, you know, well, very difficult for Habibie and then for General Mantiri. And of course, the Australian Foreign Minister and was difficult. We create some kind of, you know, diplomatic dilemma, you know, between the Australian and Indonesia at that time. But so we, after the 6, 7 weeks, we got released from the detention center. But Australia is very smart, and they didn't give us like permanent residence or so our citizens, our right for the citizens was a kind of in limbo. We were in limbo for 7, 8 years because we were not allowed to leave Australia, and we're not allowed to step out of Australia, because if we leave Australia, we're not allowed to come back into the country. So was a difficult for us, yeah. But of course, you know, our mission was just come to Australia and to show the Australian government and Australian people that the struggle for independence and freedom in Timor was exist. So and then we were there for 7, 8 years. You know, without travel documents and without a passport, and we were not allowed to leave the country until 1999 was a referendum in East Timor. And of course, you know, we all know that the Timorese people vote in favor of independence. And finally, Australian government actually granted us a special humanitarian visa, because the reason that they give us the special humanitarian visa, because you know the country was destroyed, everything, all infrastructure, you know, hospitals, schools, and everything were destroyed by the Indonesian army when they left the country. So, and then they finally gave us a special humanitarian visa, so that we are allowed to leave the country and come back. And of course, everything that we did in Australia for the last 7, 8 years was illegal. But you know, as a Timorese, we always create problems, and what they call us, the Indonesian call us, we always create problems. So we didn't care. We didn't, because our temporary visa at that time was we were not allowed to work, we were not allowed to study, but we didn't care. So we just, you know, lobby the company and lobby university and schools, and then we just go and study English. And I was very lucky that I lobbied a Catholic school, and then I went to study, and I did my completed my high school, and then I lobby Australian Catholic University, you know, to accept me to the university to study arts and education. And then when East Timor independence in 2004, I completed my double degree in Bachelor of Art and Bachelor of Education, and I went back to East Timor and work in East Timor for a number of years, and then yeah, that's how I I became, you know, actor and scriptwriting, and I co-produced Aguera de Beatriz and making Zuse's story. And then, yeah, of course, you know, this story, and I also made a short animated documentary that I think, I hope you will see it, will show in the film. It's called Zuse's Story. So it is basically based on my life story and then how it's related to this talk. So I will be happy to answer some questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everybody. And we'd also like to thank Serge for hosting us here in Coimbra, particularly Marisa Ramos Gonçalves for being one of our hosts, as well as Maria Paula Meneses. So it's great to be able to come here and share some of the story with you, because I think, as will become apparent in this presentation, Portugal comes into it a little bit in terms of the nationality of the Timorese asylum seekers and Australia's attempts to get rid of the problem, if you like, of the Timorese asylum seekers via the question of Portuguese nationality. So this is a picture of the group from the Tassidia when they arrived at the Curtin Detention Centre in 1995. So the group sailed from here, from Dili, west, slightly west of Dili, and then going around the northern part of the half island to the town of the town of Darwin here in the Northern Territory, the capital of Australia's Northern Territory. So that's the trajectory that the boat took here. And José told you a little bit about the background of the voyage, and it's worthwhile going back just a little bit further in terms of Timorese refugees and their arrival in Australia. So why the Tassidia was such a the arrival of the Tassidia in May 1995 was such a momentous occasion was because it was the only boat of asylum seekers that made it successfully to Australia during the Indonesian occupation. So before that, Timorese had arrived by boat in Australia, but large boats that were that had sailed from East Timor to Darwin. So this is an image from the National Archives in Australia of this the arrival of the Macaulay, the ship that carried, I think it went back and forth, took two boatloads of people from Dili to Darwin during the civil war between two Timorese political parties, Fretilin and UDT, the Timorese Democratic Union. So why the Tassidia was such an event was because after 1975, there were no more boat arrivals from East Timor because of the force of Indonesian rule in East Timor that prevented people from undertaking these kinds of voyages. So in this paper, what I want to focus on is the impact of the arrival of the Tassidia on Australian policy making in terms of refugee policy, immigration, as well as foreign policy. And so far, there's been little research about this boat arrival. Either people don't know about it, or people have forgotten this event. And so 2 years ago marked the 20th anniversary of the arrival of the Tassidia. And so some of the people who arrived on the boat have settled in Darwin. And as I'll show you later on, the Northern Territory News did a small article about the group of the Tassidia and where are they today, 20 years on. And for the Australian government, it was preferable, given the delicate relationship that it had with Indonesia, that the boat hadn't arrived at all. The boat brought to the fore the questions of what have the passengers of the Tassidia fled from? What was it that led them to get into a boat that then took them to Australia? They also worried that more boats from other conflict zones in Indonesian territory would come to Australia. So territories like West Papua, for example, that also have seen a lot of conflict and demands for independence. And also they worried in the mid-1990s that more boats from East Timor would arrive after the Tassidia. Before the Tassidia, in 1969 and in 1985, a small number of West Papuan asylum seekers had arrived in Northern Australia. They'd arrived in the Torres Strait Islands. So if you look back at this map, the Torres Strait Islands are these here. So it says Torres Strait here. There's very, very little distance between Papua New Guinea and the tip of Australia. And between these, in this body of water, the Torres Strait, there is a scattering of islands. So the West Papuan asylum seekers came from via the Torres Strait. Or some also came via Papua New Guinea. But it wasn't until 2006, so 11 years after the Tassie Diab, that this large number of West Papuan asylum seekers arrived in Cape York in northern Queensland on this boat here. So the Australian government had fears constantly of an exodus from Indonesian territory and how that would actually affect the relationship between Australia and Indonesia. So this paper that I'm presenting today is part of a broader research project on the origins of the Tassie Diab voyage, about the boat's passengers, what were their experiences of living in East Timor and leaving that territory and their settlement in Australia. The research is supported by the Northern Territory History Grant from the Ministry of Tourism and Culture in the Northern Territory, because of the fact that Northern Territory has become such a pivotal place in terms of the story of Timorese asylum seekers. It's also being supported by the National Library of Australia, so I'll be doing some research there as part of a fellowship in Canberra to look at particularly government reports, archival materials about the voyage and about the questions of Portuguese and Australian citizenship when it comes to this group of asylum seekers. So as Suzette already told you before, that the journey of the Tassie Diab can be linked to this deteriorating political situation in East Timor after the 12th of November Dili massacre in 1991, in which over 270 people were shot at Santa Cruz Cemetery during a funeral and protest march. And that tightening up of the political administration by Indonesia after the Dili massacre was evident in the roundups and the arrests of young people and their detention to try and break the back of that youth movement that was attempting to challenge the Indonesian occupation. So more and more young people joined the clandestine movement against Indonesian rule, partly as a response to that tightening up of political repression in the territory. And they worked as couriers connecting the support movement in the cities with the armed resistance. So the boat trip dovetailed nicely with the East Timorese resistance umbrella group, the Council for National Mulberry Resistance's decision to internationalise the issue of East Timor. Because being a small country fighting Indonesia, which is an enormous military might, is very difficult without looking towards the international partners and friends. So also though, there was a need to internationalise the struggle because of the arrest of Xanana Gusmao, which was a setback for the movement as well in 1992. So on one hand, the Dili massacre opened up opportunities for people to be in solidarity with East Timor because of the images from the massacre that were broadcast worldwide. But at the same time, the Timorese also needed that international support much more because of the setback that they'd suffered with the arrest of Xanana Gusmao as the leader of the resistance. So internationalisation seemed to be really, you know, needed to be stepped up. And for that to happen, I think the question of visibility and of the presence of Timorese asylum seekers who had been in East Timor living through the occupation was a really important part of that internationalisation strategy. To have that visibility, to have contact with Timorese people who can advocate and talk about the reality of living in East Timor under this occupation was really important. And that's the kinds of roles that people escaping East Timor in the 1990s played in terms of giving that greater visibility. The Timorese diaspora could be found mainly in Australia and in Portugal. There were small numbers living in the United States, in Canada, New Zealand, Macau. People left East Timor generally after paying large bribes to the Indonesian administration for exit visas and passports. Some also had help from the International Commission of the Red Cross to leave on humanitarian grounds. From Portugal, some also departed for Australia and entered Australia on the basis of family reunion programs in order to be closer to East Timor. In 2001, it was estimated there were approximately 9,000 people of Timorese origin living in Australia. Many, if not all of them, were involved in varying degrees in activities to free their homeland, such as fundraising and taking part in public demonstrations. In the early to mid-1990s, the last years of the Indonesian occupation, Timorese youth started to engage in spectacular activities involving third countries in an attempt to draw world attention and people into action. So, as Jose mentioned before, from 1994, Timorese youth began scaling the walls of foreign embassies in Jakarta, including the US, New Zealand and Japanese embassies. And for their safety, many of these young people were sent to Portugal rather than to be released back out into the hands of the Indonesian security forces. In December 1995, this is this image on the left here that you see, on the 20th anniversary of Indonesia's invasion, on the 7th of December, Timorese youth and Indonesians in a radical student group called Indonesian Student Solidarity with Democracy scaled the walls of the Dutch and Russian embassies in Jakarta. They didn't seek asylum to use a different tactic compared to people who had sought asylum, because they said their intention was only to draw public attention to the occupation of East Timor. Afterwards, these young people in that image on the left were captured and beaten by the police. But this upsurge in youth activism is some of the context in which the voyage of the Tasiidiaq took place. So these are some of the people who were involved in organising the voyage of the Tasiidiaq. So we have Florentino das Neves, we have José here, and Alfredo Reynado. And Alfredo Reynado was killed in 2008, supposedly for attempting to assassinate Timorese president José Ramos Horta, and he was shot in some kind of a battle, a gun battle in East Timor. And Florentino and José live in Darwin today. And Antonio Gouveia was a clandestine student leader, youth leader in another part of Dili, who also organised a group of his followers to come on the boat trip. And so this group of the three brought others, and Gouveia also brought others along on the boat with him. So the three already tried this voyage before, but they didn't have a good enough boat, and the boat soon sank, but it was just a trial run. So then they tried again a couple of years later with a better boat and with a bigger group of people, and this time they would make it all the way to Australia with a few others along with them. So in Darwin, the Timorese community and solidarity activists waited anxiously for them to arrive. And on the 29th of May, the CNRM, the National Council for Mulberry Resistance, representative wrote to the Federal Immigration Minister, Nick Bolkus, to say that the boat was coming. And the boat arrived in the early hours of the 30th of May in Darwin. Then, as Jose said, that they were taken to Curtin Detention Centre. There were some attempts by, this is Jose Guzmán here, from the CNRM representative in Darwin, and this is the Tasiidiaq Group's solicitor and barrister, Colin McDonald. So they tried to have the group be allowed to stay in Darwin with Timorese families who would host them, but the Australian government had introduced by 1994 a policy of mandatory detention of all illegal boat arrivals to Australia, which meant that they were hard-pressed to treat the Timorese differently to anybody else who would have arrived by boat. So unfortunately, they didn't escape the regime of mandatory detention as well at this time. So for one night, they were allowed to remain in Darwin. There was an injunction, a federal court injunction, preventing their removal to anywhere else. So for one night, they were accommodated in Darwin, but the lawyers were unable to gain an extension to that injunction on their removal. So as soon as the injunction expired, they were flown to the Curtin Detention Centre, which is in northwest Western Australia. So there's a historian of Australia's asylum policies called Claire Higgins, who writes about this period of the introduction of mandatory detention. And she shows in her work that immigration officials thought that illegal arrivals in general should be isolated from the Australian population to avoid the impression that these arrivals, these illegal arrivals, were already accepted and allowed to settle permanently in Australia. So to push them into somewhere else, into detention, is to prevent people from getting the impression that they were already allowed to stay in Australia. So the creation of isolated detention sites away from Australia's major population centres on the east coast started with the opening of detention centres in Western Australia. So the first one was Port Hedland in 1991, then it was followed by Curtin Detention Centre here in 1995. And these images are a lot later, a few years later than 1995. I think they were taken in the 2000s, but so it assures me that this is also the way the centre looked in 1995 as well. So Curtin Detention Centre continued to be used for a number of years by the Australian government to detain asylum seekers. It's about, it's next to an Australian Air Force base, and the town of Derby, which is the town nearest to Curtin, has a population of about 3,000 people. It, the site itself is also about 6 kilometres away from the main road. It's a very isolated part of the country. So because, however, there is a provision in the Australian, in the Migration Act of 1958, there's a provision that was inserted in there that people could be released from detention sooner if they had been affected by trauma. For example, if they'd been tortured in the past, there was a provision in the Migration Act that said that people should be released earlier because ongoing detention could very well affect them badly, yeah, because of their previous trauma. So because of that, the Australian government was notified by their lawyers, by Colin MacDonald, that there was a possibility that the Timorese could get out of detention by virtue of that provision of the Act, that they had suffered trauma in the past. So after 6 or 7 weeks, they were released after they were assessed by counsellors from who'd been flown all the way from Melbourne, thousands of kilometres away, to assess the 17 adults from the Tassidia. So they came from an organisation called the Victorian Foundation for the Survivors of Torture. A team of people were flown up there. So by this time, the indication that I've had from the interviews I've conducted is that the Australian government felt that a group of Timorese asylum seekers being detained was an unintended outcome of the policy of mandatory detention. That the image of the Australian government detaining Timorese who had fled from Indonesian persecution was politically very unpalatable for the Australian public because of the existence not only of a strong Timorese diaspora but also a strong solidarity movement for East Timor. So this is a difficult situation for the Australian government. So they were very happy that there was a provision of the Migration Act that would allow them to expedite the release of the Timorese from detention, because they didn't really want the Timorese to be a focus of campaigns and activism by them being in detention. So on the 20th of July, the group, they were released on bridging visas into the care of host families in Melbourne, Sydney and Darwin. So the bridging visas were introduced, like mandatory detention, by the Australian Labor Party-led government of Paul Keating. And these were, as Jose indicated, people were not allowed to work or study in Australia, and the Timorese suffered extreme financial hardship as a result of that, because they became dependent on Timorese host families that also had their own financial problems as because of their status as asylum seekers and recent migrants. So how did this slideshow, has a mind of its own, How did the Tasidiak case affect Australia-Indonesia relations? So as I mentioned before, the detention of a group of Timorese asylum seekers was unexpected, given the lack of maritime arrivals from Indonesian territory. The policy of mandatory detention had been directed to those who had arrived from Indochina, from Cambodia and Vietnam from 1989 onwards. But with the existence of a sizable Timorese diaspora, the question was, it's not a good look to be locking up a group of Timorese in Australia. So releasing them on bridging visas reduced that pressure on the Australian government somewhat. But the Indonesian government was very angry about the fact that the Timorese were allowed to stay, even though temporarily, in Australia. So Indonesian Foreign Minister, where is he? Ali Alatas, here he is here. This is where they are toasting, celebrating the signing of the Timor Gap Treaty, which is a treaty about dividing oil and gas resources between Australia and Indonesia. And this is the Foreign Minister of Australia, Gareth Evans. And Ali Alatas condemned the decision, arguing that the Timorese were not genuine refugees. But Foreign Minister Gareth Evans said, he makes no apology for the application of Australia's refugee processing procedures and principles to this case. And so the way the Australian government defended the decision was to say, we are only following what is expected of us as a signatory to the 1951 Refugee Convention. So it's a way to try to pacify the Indonesians who are angry about this decision to allow the Timorese to stay in Australia. But this caused a lot of consternation in Jakarta, where the ambassador, Australian ambassador to Indonesia, Alan Taylor in Jakarta, made assurances to the Indonesians that, don't worry, the issuing of bridging visas doesn't mean they're allowed to stay permanently, it's just a temporary measure while we assess their claims. So the assessment of claims actually took a very, very long time for the Timorese, not just for Jose's group, but also there were 1,600 other Timorese who were awaiting determination of their status. So some of them had come from the early 1990s, and it took them over 10 years to have any kind of determination of their status. Jose's already mentioned the relationship with Indonesia over the appointment of, here he is, Herman Mantiri, who was, he was a former army officer. He was a commander of East Timor after the Dili massacre, and he defended the decision of the army to shoot the protesters at the Santa Cruz cemetery, saying these people were, you know, provoking some kind of an action, therefore the army had to take certain measures. Because of those comments, there was a large opposition in Australia against him becoming ambassador to Australia. There was a big movement to reject his candidature. And this is exactly what the Australian government did. They agreed to reject the nomination and asked Indonesia to nominate another ambassador. And in protest, Indonesia kept the position empty for 5 months. There was no ambassador in Canberra at all for the rest of 1995. So another interesting observation is that the Indonesian press was also very silent on the escape of the boat from East Timor. So I conducted a search through Indonesia's largest newspaper called Kompas from the time the boat left East Timor until around August 1995. And for about 6 weeks from the time the boat departed from Dili, there was no coverage, not one article on the escape of this boat, even though the boat had arrived in Australia within a week of leaving Dili. And one speculation that I have about why that is that the Indonesian government had hope that the Australian government would reject the group would be returned, and they wouldn't need to talk about it. They wouldn't need to talk about this boat trip having occurred at all. But when the Australian government provided them with bridging visas, it really changed the game. They then needed to report on this in such a way that portrayed the refugees in a very negative, the asylum seekers in a very negative light. And that's certainly what they did. So at the end of July, these mysterious reports started appearing in the Indonesian newspaper saying, this group of people are just a bunch of criminals. They're not genuine refugees. So if you're reading that without any form of background about what had happened and who these people were, it's astounding to think, oh, what's this about? And it's a symptom of the Indonesian press in the early to mid-1990s that was heavily censored, where newspapers were banned. So in 1994, three newspapers and magazines were banned and had their licenses to publish suspended. So it's a function, the reason why it's like that, the reason why there is this silence in the Indonesian media is of course because of the state of the media at the time, which was under heavy control of the authoritarian government of President Suharto. So the Australian government though didn't stop there, but what they did was they tried to push the asylum seekers onto Portugal to deal with. So the Australian government began to try to shift the burden of protection to the Portuguese government because they'd been East Timor's former colonial rulers. Prime Minister Paul Keating wanted to protect the relationship with Indonesia because the relationship with President Suharto was the most important relationship diplomatically that Australia had. This is the position, certainly, of the Australian Labor government of the mid-1990s. So when he was asked about the issue of protection for the 18 asylum seekers, Prime Minister Keating argued that they had Portuguese citizenship and could avail themselves of protection from that country. So he told the Guardian newspaper in October 1995, and this is a quote, though the government has taken the view that East Timor is a province of Indonesia, those people still have Portuguese citizenship and status. These people have dual citizenship, therefore they cannot argue they are refugees. So Australia was the only country to give de jure recognition to the Indonesian occupation. It was the only country that recognised Indonesia as the rightful ruler of East Timor. So it's contradictory to say one thing and then to argue that these people can still have Portuguese citizenship. But the origins of this claim by Prime Minister Keating can be traced back to attempts from 1993 by the Australian Refugee Review Tribunal, the RRT, to suggest that 1,600 Timorese asylum seekers who had been in Australia since the early 1990s could claim protection from Portugal. So the RRT is a section of the Administrative Appeals Tribunal that reviews government decisions on refugee applications. So if you fail to be classified as a refugee, you can appeal to the RRT to review that decision. The RRT sought advice from Portuguese legal academics, including from this university, regarding the nationality of the Timorese. So because the RRT wanted to show that the Timorese had the option of taking up Portuguese citizenship under Portuguese national law. So the argument goes that since the Timorese did not hold fears of persecution from Portugal, under Section 1A of the Refugee Convention, asylum seekers who had dual nationalities, and this is coming from the convention itself, are not thought to be lacking in protection if, without any valid reason, based on a well-founded fear. So if they're not afraid of Portugal doing something bad to their human rights, then they can ask for protection from Portugal. Therefore, they don't need to ask for protection from Australia because they are protected by one of their dual nationalities. Now, the question in this is that Indonesia doesn't recognise dual nationalities. So if you would seem to be holding Indonesian citizenship, you cannot be a dual nationality by virtue of that. So that's one technical argument against that. But that's the RRT that put forward this particular line of thinking. But the Australian government soon heard about this reasoning of the RRTs and thought this is a very good idea to try and argue for Portuguese nationality, and that way you would be able to solve the issue of Timorese asylum seekers. So throughout 1995, the year that the Tasi Diak arrived, Australian immigration officials communicated with the Portuguese ambassador in Canberra, inquiring what was his understanding what was his interpretation of the Portuguese nationality law? Were the Timorese covered or not? Australia also sought international legal advice from within its own Attorney General's Department about the citizenship status of the East Timorese. So Australia's proposal to deny protection to the East Timorese asylum seekers led to that organisation, the Victorian Foundation for the Survivors of Torture, to give a confidential submission to the Australian government to say, this is what we know about the traumatic experiences of 50 East Timorese clients that they had, and that they felt that it would negatively affect the Timorese to go onto this citizenship argument that they are trying to run. So they were very concerned about how this would affect the Timorese asylum seekers, to the extent that an NGO that just provided trauma counselling wanted to urge the government not to do this. But Portugal wasn't cooperative in this effort. So they didn't want to take the Timorese asylum seekers off Australia's hands at all. Because one of the reasons was that Portugal was embroiled in a legal case against Australia in the International Court of Justice, the ICJ. In 1991, Portugal brought a case against Australia to the ICJ, challenging the legality of this treaty, the Timor Gap Treaty, between Australia and Indonesia to develop oil and gas resources in the Timor Sea. So this is the court case here. The case ran for 4 years, from 1991 to 1995. After 4 years, the court ruled on the 30th of June 1995 that it couldn't decide on the case without examining the legality or otherwise of the Indonesian presence in East Timor. So Portugal says Australia doesn't have the right to negotiate with Indonesia because the presence of Indonesia in East Timor was illegal. And the judges responded by saying that the legality of Indonesian occupation is not what is being discussed at the ICJ, because part of the reason was because Indonesia wasn't a party to the case. The case was between Portugal and Australia. So the case lapsed. Given this adverse judgment at the ICJ, Portugal was therefore probably highly unlikely to help Australia with its asylum seeker problem, yeah, asylum seeker quandary. In 1995, over several items of correspondence, the Portuguese ambassador emphasised the voluntary nature of nationality. People cannot be made to take up nationality. They have to volunteer for that. People can take up Portuguese citizenship. They can apply for it should they choose to do so. And the Portuguese ambassador also said that his country was unwilling to conclude any deal of taking asylum seekers from Australia's hands. So the Portuguese ambassador said, do not announce that there is any kind of deal between our two countries, because that is not what we are, that we will not do that. Yeah. The argument of Portuguese nationality was tested in the Federal Court of Australia in 1997 and 1998, and in the Administrative Appeals Tribunal in 2000. All these cases were in response to appeals by Timorese who had their refugee applications rejected. In each case, the tribunals ruled against the idea of Portuguese nationality. They argued, the members and the judges argued, that it was not what they termed effective nationality. And this is an important distinction. It wasn't effective nationality for the Timorese to access. It was not protection that they could access readily. So what the Australian government did in response was to change the Migration Act to take no account of effective nationality. So the argument about effective nationality is gone from the Migration Act, choosing instead to rely on just whatever the country's domestic law says. So Portuguese law says Timorese who are born before a certain year can take up Portuguese nationality by virtue of Portugal still being the sovereign, the ruler, if you like, the power that was responsible for East Timor, then that is what the Australian government will go by. They are not going to entertain ideas of effective nationality. They are just going to take that as it is. If Portuguese law says they are covered, then they're covered. So 1999, I'm just going to move to the conclusion here. In 1999, Indonesia withdrew from East Timor following the UN supervised referendum, in which the an overwhelming majority of Timorese voted to separate from Indonesia. So this leaves the Timorese asylum seekers in great uncertainty, because now there is no longer the factor of Indonesian repression over them, because Indonesia is no longer in the territory. So where does this leave the Timorese? Because the Australian government had taken so long to process each of the Timorese cases, taking up to 10 years in some instances, that it started to place the Timorese in a very uncertain position. And the government change in Australia, then the Liberal, i.e. Conservative government, was in power, and they saw this, the change of situation in East Timor, as a way to repatriate the Timorese asylum seekers, because the Indonesian threat was no longer there. So there was a big campaign in Australia to form what was called the Sanctuary Network. And it was initiated by a Catholic nun, Sister Cath O'Connor, to form this thing called the Sanctuary Network. And hundreds of Australians signed up and pledged to hide Timorese asylum seekers who might be at risk of deportation if the government starts to deport asylum seekers. As Jose mentioned before, the Australian government resolved this impasse by simply granting the Timorese special humanitarian visas. In about 2003, if my memory serves me correctly, the Australian government commissioned a parliamentary briefing paper about this problem of the Timorese asylum seekers. What are the options open to the government? And there were some options that were canvassed in it. One of them was to have the special humanitarian visa. Now, the special humanitarian visa is not an acknowledgement that the Timorese have refugee status. So it's a way to not give them refugee status. By doing this, they do not pass any form of judgment on Indonesian rule over the territory. So here's a humanitarian visa, we allow you to stay. And they did talk about repatriating the Timorese back to East Timor, but the ambassador of East Timor to Australia, Abel Guterres, at the time said, we will not be ready to accept anybody really to return to our country for maybe 10 years after our country was heavily destroyed by Indonesia when it was withdrawing. So the humanitarian visa is really just to, for me, in my view, it's not because East Timor was destroyed, but it's really to make the East Timor problem go away without there being acknowledgement that people suffered and had grounds to be refugees under Indonesian rule. So nobody has, from coming from Indonesian territory, has ever had refugee status given to them. So the Australian government has never passed any judgment on Indonesian rule over its territory, whether it's Papua or the other areas of Indonesia, by giving these special humanitarian visas. And this is, as I mentioned to you, this is coverage from the Northern Territory News in 2015, with some of the people who arrived on the Tasidia, who'd made Darwin their home. So now, because the Australian government took so long in granting these visas, a number of people gave up waiting and returned to East Timor. And even though it had taken them years and years of being in limbo to wait on the outcome of their cases. And now the Tasidia passengers are spread between Australia and Timor-Leste. Some have returned, but most remain in Australia, living in Darwin, in Melbourne, in the smaller towns of Australia as well. So before the Tasidia had arrived, as I mentioned before, there hadn't been any significant history of asylum seekers arriving by boat, fleeing from Indonesian persecution. Indonesia expected Australia to reject the claims immediately, given the good relationship between the two countries, but Australia embarked on a series of policy twists and turns to try to keep the diplomatic crisis at bay, to try to protect the relationship. As well as that, it wanted to protect its image domestically and overseas about how it handled asylum seekers, therefore for giving them humanitarian visas, bridging visas and so on. But the human costs to the Timorese, the effects of waiting and of being shrouded in uncertainty for years and years, is something that remains to be acknowledged, that human cost. So, and it has resonances in terms of Australian policies today towards the detention indefinitely of asylum seekers that arrive by boat. So today, if the Tassie-Dieppe passengers were to embark on a similar voyage, they would be incarcerated and detained in either Manus Island or in Nauru, and not allowed to step onto the Australian mainland. So the lessons of the Tassie-Dieppe, I think, is in the pragmatism that is present in foreign policy and in the way that Australia deals with asylum seekers. And the Migration Act, just by way of a final comment, the Migration Act of Australia is amended so frequently to take into account unexpected events that occur in the way that people seek asylum in Australia. And today, the evidence of torture and trauma alone would not get people out of detention in the way that it did for the group of asylum seekers that arrive on the Tassie-Dieppe. So I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.